I love a good rattly box, because at least for me, if the box is rattling, it probably means there are rocks inside. All right, so these are Lake Superior agates, and you can find them on various beaches, especially around the west side of the lake. Except, I will be honest with you, I am trash at finding agates, so I did buy these. In this region, agates are usually pretty small, relatively red or orange striped rocks, but they're found all over the world and can take on a variety of colors and patterns. But what gets me about these things isn't the dopamine hit you theoretically get when you find one of these in the wild. It's that even though thousands of people find rocks like these on the beach every year, agates are one of the only major gemstones that scientists don't know how to synthesize. They've been studying these things for thousands of years, and they still don't know how agates form. The thing about agates is that they're not rare. They've been found on every continent, and they've been forming on Earth for basically as long as there's been an Earth. Although there are some exceptions, most agates seem to form not long after the rock they're found in. So Lake Superior agates formed in air bubbles in roughly 1.1 billion year old lava rock, which means the agates are likely somewhere in the ballpark of 1.1 billion years old. And that makes them among the oldest agates in the world. They're also probably the oldest agates you can just like casually pick up on a beach somewhere. Still, even these stones are babies compared to the record holder, which was found in Western Australia in rock almost 3.5 billion years old. For reference, the Earth itself is only about a billion years older than that, and for much of that early history, it was just too hot for agates to even form. As for where agates ultimately come from, well, for context, agates are mostly made of the mineral quartz. Quartz is one of the most common minerals on Earth, and there are all kinds of categories and subcategories of it based on what the crystals look like. For instance, agates are largely made of microscopic quartz crystals, which makes them a type of chalcedony. And agates are, well, agates because they're banded chalcedony. They have those bands of color. Although I have seen some sources say they just need to be translucent to be counted as agates, but I'm not gonna weigh in there. Regardless, the broad strokes for making one of these gems seem straightforward enough. First, you start with some kind of cavity. Like I mentioned earlier, the cavities in my area were little gas bubbles in lava rock, which is why Lake Superior agates tend to be relatively small. But these cavities can basically be anything, including cracks in rock, and also even things like pores in bone, which is amazing. Once you have your cavity, whatever it is, you then run fluid through it, like groundwater. And the key is that that fluid has to contain a good amount of silica, because over time, that silica starts to crystallize on the walls of the cavity. And from there, it seems to grow inward toward the center or in flatter layers, depending on the conditions. The colors and bands in agates then come from variations in the crystal structure and from different minerals in the original fluid. So for instance, Lake Superior agates tend to have a lot of reds, oranges, and yellows thanks to iron in the groundwater. But in other areas, you can get a whole rainbow of colors. But one way or another, crystallization eventually continues until, boom, you have an agate. Now, when I first learned this, I was honestly really surprised that scientists have never managed to grow an agate in a lab. Like, based on that general explanation, I assumed you would just need some water, some silica, and like, I don't know, maybe some bonus atoms for color. It would be like growing really pretty, just super inedible rock candy. But here's what I learned. That broad summary I gave about how agates seem to form, it leaves a lot out. Like, I didn't say anything about how long this process takes, exactly where in the earth the silica comes from, what form the silica takes, or even exactly when and how these bands of color form. Like, for a while, researchers have been investigating whether agates form all at once from some kind of like silica gel, or if the bands of color build up independently, potentially over millions of years. But ultimately, they don't have answers to these questions, or the dozens of other very detail-oriented questions about things like structures and layers and microscopic textures. To give you another example, although agates are mostly made of the mineral quartz, there's another crystal in there as well. It's made of the same kinds of atoms, but just with a different structure. It's called moganite, and it makes up maybe 10% of an agate. But where does that come from? And what determines whether you get quartz or moganite as your agate is forming? Really, the exact research questions here here are beyond the scope of this video, but to give you a sense of how involved this kind of work is, while I was researching this, I exchanged a few emails with Dr. Peter Heaney, a professor at Penn State University who has done extensive work on this topic. And the kinds of questions he's looked into get all the way down to the molecular level and involve things like how chains of silica molecules grow and connect and twist through 3D space as an agate is forming. The theme is, these relatively common gems are incredibly complex. And while scientists might not need to answer, you know, every single one of these questions to grow an agate in a lab, being able to replicate these microscopic textures is important. And that's something scientists just don't understand well enough to know how to do. Now, to be fair, some of the reason agates are surrounded in so much mystery is demand related. Like, some gems can teach us about what the Earth was like when that gem formed, or even about conditions on other planets. But agates can't do that, so they're really not that high on the research priority list. Or the industry priority list, for that matter. Agates aren't a super popular jewelry item, and like, you know, despite my own personal incompetence, they're not actually that hard to find. Still, it's not like no research has gone into this either. As part of prepping for this video, I read most of a 200-page special edition of the journal Minerals, which came out in 2021 and was exclusively about agates. So is it possible that these questions could be answered someday? Absolutely. But as another expert put it, it is a worthy challenge that is closer to the beginning of its history than the end. So for now, if you find an agate on a beach somewhere, or tucked away in the corner of a gift shop, know that you're finding a lovely, shiny curiosity, sure, but you're also finding a puzzle and something that only nature knows how to create. Thank you so much to Linda for the story idea and for helping to make this particular video possible. And a special thanks as well to Dr. Peter Heaney for helping me understand some complex science. If you enjoy stories like this about geology and history, and especially the Midwest and the state of Michigan, I post videos like this about twice a month right here on YouTube. And you are more than welcome to subscribe and follow along. Right now, I am also working on videos about a waterfall and a shipwreck, so there's stuff happening. One way or another, thanks for being here. I hope you learned something that makes you think about the world just a little differently, and I'll see you soon.